let's turn to Jaume Ventura.
Thanks, Jordi. Thank you very much for having me here. I totally agree with Xavier in the fact that when I saw the question, I thought I would have very little to say about the question, and I accept perhaps going into an exercise of saying we are guilty, we're not guilty, these guys are wrong, these guys are right, something that I don't think I have any interest in doing or the comparative advantage, but nonetheless, I felt that this is an important issue. So what I did, Jordi, without your permission, but hopefully, with your, I hope that you'll find appropriate. I asked the question, and I changed it a little bit, and I tried to think about the issue of, instead of where were the economists, I was thinking of where were the crises in our models, or where were the crises in the way we think about the macroeconomy, and we think about the world. We've been writing macroeconomic models for a long, long time. I'm going to narrow it. I'm going to think about issues within the context of macroeconomic models. I'm a macroeconomist, and that's, I'm not going to go into banking issues or incentives, especially having Xavier sitting next to me. But I want to think about the issue of where were the crises in our models, and how can we think about this? If there's anything that we have learned in the last 20 years of macroeconomic history, is that asset prices move a lot. They move in a way that we find it very hard to connect to movements on fundamentals, or movements on other prices, or on other factors that we think are going to drive prices, and we don't have that in our macro models. All the macro models central banks use, all the macro models that academics use in general in the sight of macro, prices are always a net present value of their dividends. And I think that as a profession or as a field, we are now at a crossroads. We can no longer ignore that, or no, can no longer do fixes like saying there's a shock on asset prices or there's a shock on a risk premium somewhere in the model. And and let's say where it comes from, but let's trace the macroeconomic effects. We can no longer do that because these shocks have become probably the most important shock and actually the main driver of economic activity in industrial economies, and I would say also in emerging markets. And when we are at that crossroads, I have to go back and dig and say, how do we bring those crises? Where are they? How do we bring them into our models? And I want to say a few things or a few thoughts about this topic in this panel. In particular, one of the most malign hypotheses or a most malign discussion that has, most malign economic theory that has during these days is the efficient markets hypothesis. You have all heard it, and you've all heard it in a very bad light recently. But the efficient market hypothesis, when you go back, is when you look back at the original papers about it, it says that if prices are equal to the net present value, then the market is using information efficiently. If the market is using information efficiently and an additional condition takes place, which is a very important additional condition, then prices will be equal to the net present value. For a long time, if you want to write a model in which prices will depart from fundamentals and in a way that we can understand, you can take one of two roads. One road is that we are not using information efficiently, so there's a failure of rationality somehow. And the other road is to take the escape clause, that this additional condition that many of you know, and those of you that don't know, is the condition that some sort of transversality condition applies. It doesn't apply in our models. So these are the kind of the two ways to go. One way, the models that have been written using this escape clause, the notion that there's no reason why collectively some sort of transversality condition would apply, have not been very successful. In fact, there is wonderful research back in the 80s, done mostly for Jean Tirole and other people that followed his work, like Philippe Bayle, that tried to model standard models. They took a standard solo Ramsey-Stalton model, and they started to put asset bubbles in there because they found situations in which this transversality condition didn't work. These models were beautiful because you could use these models to analyze asset shocks. how, for example, the models would have something that we sorely miss now, which is the fact that some changes of expectations would change asset prices and have very, very large effects on economic activity. The problem was that the appearance of these bubbles or the appearance of these shocks would lead to downturns. So when the bubble arises, people stop investing, buys the bubble, output and capital stock falls, and the economy goes into a recession. So on the one hand, for the first time, we were able to write models in which these shocks arise naturally within the context of the model, but the macroeconomic impact of that we were tracing with our model seemed to have nothing to do with the sort of bubble episodes that we have been seeing in the past. The bubble episodes we have been seeing in the past are periods in which, when the bubble comes, investment, aggregate activity, output, everything goes up and everybody's very happy. Those were not the stories that you could see out of this model.